Just let me have a word of prayer, and we'll go ahead and get started today. Gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time. We thank you for how you love us and care for us, and we pray, Father, that as we worship you today, everything that we say, do, sing, whatever, Father, all that brings glory to you and reminds, helps us understand how much you love us, but also helps us communicate to you how much we love you. We thank you for this time, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Chelsea?
Good morning, everyone. You glad to be here worshiping our Lord? Well, before we begin, I just want to say that we do have our guitarist here, Emily, who is going to college this week, so we will miss her. I'm not going to say anymore because I'll probably get sad. but why don't we stand and we'll begin with worship.
Hallelujah, God. sing. There's a reason for this life inside me. One name above all names, Jesus. Yes, it's Jesus. There's a reason for this hope. There's a reason for this peace that I know. One worthy of all praise.
Good morning once again. Welcome to South End Baptist Church. For those of you who are joining us in person or on the live stream or even watching it later today, recorded at some point, we just welcome you and thank you again for worshiping with us. If you are here in person in the pew in front of you, if it's your first time with us, there's a connection card that you could fill out on the front with your information. You can drop it in the offering plate here in just a couple minutes when it comes by. You can drop it out on one of the plates outside as you leave, or you could even just leave it on the pew and it'll get picked up and your information will be given to the office and you'll be contacted for further information. And for everybody on the back, there's a spot for prayer requests, praises, whatever you feel led by God to put on there. Again, if you drop it in the offering plate as it comes by, it'll be collected and somebody will be praying for those requests throughout the service today and over the coming weeks. I'm going to change my prayer a little bit. Yesterday, we had our back-to-school bash here. It was actually a really good success. We gave out 73 bags of supplies to area kids. So, grateful that we were able to do that and reach our community. There was also 15 bags of food that was gathered up from a donation, and they were given out to some of the needy families as they came through as well. So just a way that we were able to touch and reach our community. I know families are taking college kids back to school or off for the first time to school. So I just want to take our time now and pray for this upcoming school year for all the students and for the parents. So if you'll join with me. Dear Lord, we thank you now for this time where we can come and just lift up our service to you. We've already sung praises up to you, dear Lord. We're getting ready to hear what you've given to Pastor Mike to preach to us and look at in your word, dear Lord. But just now I want to lift up this time to this upcoming school year that's started for some around the country, that's getting ready to start. Kids that are off to college, either returning or for the first time, just be in prayer that those that know you will be able to use this time to spread to their friends and others about you, dear Lord, and just know that you're with them and with their families, dear Lord, and as they go through all this experience, and just grateful that we were able to reach out to our community around us and help those in need that, you know, are struggling with getting supplies or just need the extra stuff that they needed, dear Lord. And again, just ways that, you know, we're grateful that we're able to be there for our community and show our love for them. And now again, as we lift up the rest of this service, this offering time to you, as that's collected, will help with the furtherment of your kingdom in a way like we did yesterday. In your precious son's name, amen.
Righty, folks, how are we doing today? Okay, all right, we'll go with that. Anyway, if you have your copy of God's Word, we're in Galatians chapter 1. We're going to start a new book today. We, yes, are through with the book of Amos, so we're going to move on into the New Testament, Galatians, and it's an interesting book just to give y'all, after we spend some time in prayer, we'll talk about it a little bit, Galatians 1, verses 1 through 10. So if you are able, would you stand with me in honor of reading God's Word this morning, Galatians 1, verses 1 through 10, and then we'll dive in. And the Apostle Paul writes, and you know this is his letter because he tells you it's his letter, as he always does. Paul, an apostle not sent from men, nor through the agency of man, but through Jesus Christ and God the Father who raised him from the dead, and all the brethren who are with me, to the churches of Galatia. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself for our sins so that he might rescue us from this present age, according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever more. Amen. I am amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel, which is really not another, only there are some who are disturbing you and want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached to you, he is to be accursed. As we have said before, so I say again now, if any man is preaching to you a gospel contrary to what you received, he is to be accursed. For am I now seeking the favor of men or of God? Or am I striving to please men? If I were still striving to please men, I would not be a bondservant of Christ. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you how the apostle speaks to us today, and I pray, Father, use me as your vessel to faithfully communicate your word to each of us, your people today, that we might hear your word and our hearts might be transformed and changed, and we might seek to live in a way that glorifies, honors, and exalts you. For this life is all about you, knowing you, and making you known. Thank you for your love, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Well, a little bit of background about Galatia, where we're going to be talking about. This is one of Paul's letters, and probably of his letters, this is one of the ones with that speaks about some things that are pretty for, I don't know how to say this in the best, how do I say it in the most appropriate, no. He just pretty much is blunt here, okay? He's going to lay it out, what grace is, what it means to be a follower of Christ, and those that have violated that teaching, he's going to be very harsh on them, and we'll talk a little bit about that. But Galatia is a region, if you can kind of, in your mind, if you've seen a map, you can see where Turkey is, kind of right in the middle of Turkey, with a slight bit of coast, just right up in the middle, that's where Galatia was. As we know, that's as we understand it. And it was a region where Paul had planted a church and had had that continuing relationship with them and was concerned about some things that were going on in that era. And as he mentioned here, as you kind of sense the tone of this, he starts off, you know, with a typical greeting that he gives in many of his epistles and letters and reminds them of the great grace that God has performed in them. And then he jumps right in to the whole reason for this letter, because there was a group of individuals, which you've heard me talk about before, who are mentioned in several of his letters. We see them laid out in the book of Acts. They are known as the Judaizers. And what the Judaizers, who they were Jewish leaders who were teaching that what you need to be a follower of Christ is you need Jesus, yes, but you need to observe the teachings of the law as well. It kind of comes together. So it was a, you know, your salvation was not by grace through faith. Your salvation was by Jesus plus observing the law. That's how it worked. And that was what they taught. And what are some of the rituals they really focused on? One of the key ones was the ritual of circumcision. They believed was essential. That's where kind of the rubber met the road in that, for lack of a better phrase. They were really struggling and trying to help people understand that belief of theirs. And Paul is coming against that because he has seen that distortion of the gospel, because that's exactly what it is, a distortion of the gospel, was infecting some of the folks, and they were struggling with trying to understand what it meant to be a follower of Christ. Now, I am so glad today that no one distorts the teachings of God's word at all, right? Unfortunately, that still goes on in different ways in the Church of Jesus Christ. And even in the name of our Savior and Lord, there are some that have said some things that are, in all honesty, very similar to what we're going to look at today, teachings that try to add to what Christ has already accomplished. And so that's kind of what the focus is as we look at the entire book. But as we look at this today, these first few verses, Paul is just laying out kind of, this is what I'm going to talk about. This is what I'm concerned about. I love you, but we need to get to the point and we need to solve this, because he saw this great distortion of the gospel as causing a problem in the church in Galatia and other churches as well. He talks about this, but really focuses here. And also really, this is at the very, literally the infancy of the gospel and the kingdom of God's work in the world. When you think about it, this is at the beginning. And if this is allowed to continue, it will distort what Christ came to accomplish, and we will have a gospel that is not the gospel, but a distortion of it. So anyway, that's the background. You can breathe now. I can breathe, I guess. I'm done for a second or two. But that's the heart of what we're going to look at over the next few weeks. Thought it was a, you know, as God was helping me say, where do I go? What I, you know, I asked God, where do you want me to go? And this is where he led me to go to this book. So I think it will be, I hope, a helpful time. But also, I think it will be a time that will challenge and encourage us and remind us of the purity of the gospel of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, that salvation comes by Christ and Christ alone. There is absolutely nothing that we add to it that we can do to make our salvation complete apart from trusting in our Savior and Lord Jesus Christ and the finished work of the cross that he has accomplished. Anything added to that, even if it's a good thing, is wrong. Because what they were adding to it were not bad things. They weren't saying you had to go out and kill six people or do something stupid like that. They were saying you needed to observe some of the rituals that we have observed for centuries. You need to be a part of that culture before you fully understand the gospel and really embrace it. And Paul, who was, interesting, what do you remember what race Paul was a part of before he became a follower of Christ, what he was very adamant about? Do you remember? Well, killing Christians, but he was Jewish, right? And And not, you know, there are many people in the world who have a particular, and they're, and I'll be honest, they're Jewish by race, but their faith is not really anything connected to the Jewish faith of the Scriptures. But Paul was very connected. In fact, he was He was a Pharisee. If you remember, Jesus had a lot of interaction with the Pharisees. He was very adamant about his teachings. He was very bold. He was very knowledgeable. He knew a great deal of the scriptures. He understood the Old Testament quite well. And he is one who's concerned that it has been twisted to say something it was never meant to say, because he understood after his meeting with Jesus on the road to Damascus that his salvation, his hope, was not in his heritage. It was not anything that he could do. It was all in what Christ had done for him. And he emphasizes that again and again throughout his letters, which I'm very grateful for, but I think it's an incredibly important, powerful truth for us to grab onto. Because sometimes there are things that are said, and YouTube's a dangerous place. Have you noticed that? There's some good stuff on there, and there's some people that I think you don't need to watch. Because there's some heretics on YouTube. I'm sorry. I watched a guy the other day because he had an interesting heading, and I kind of watched it, and he started talking. I'm like, oh my gosh, you're going down this road? Yeah, he did. And he basically laid out the same heresy that is talked about here. That if you wanted to be a follower of Christ, you had to do all these different things on top of it. That the blood of Jesus is not enough to save me. I've got to add something to it. That's what you're saying here. And Paul is saying quite clearly, no, brothers and sisters, it is Christ and Christ alone. If there was something that you or I could add to it to make our salvation, then we wouldn't need Jesus. Right? But that's not true. There is nothing that I bring to my salvation. Nothing I bring except the sin that made it necessary. There's nothing that I bring to it. I don't add to it. There's not like, you know, and it's good to go to church. It's good to read my Bible. It's good to pray. Those are important things to help me grow. But those aren't the reasons why I can say I'm a child of God. The reason why I can say I'm a child of God is because Jesus Christ died on a cross for me, as he did for you. And I've repented of my sins and given my life to him and trusted in him. It is all about what Jesus does. When I stand before God, it will not be, well, I was a pastor, so. Well, I went to church from the time I was before I could even make a choice. I was always in church, right? Isn't that good, God? That's fine, but that doesn't mean you're my child. The reason I'm his child, the reason any of us are his children, is because of what Jesus has done for us, that we have trusted in that. Does that make sense? And that's the heart of what Paul is trying to get across, and yet that simple, concise, powerful message can get so easily distorted when we think that we need to do something more. We're putting it on ourselves. Salvation cannot be earned. Amen? I can't earn it. It's all about what Jesus Christ has done for us. That's why when Jesus, I believe why Jesus said, I mean, he made it pretty clear when he was on the cross, what were the last words he said? It is finished. I'm done. I've done everything I came to do. I mean, it is complete. Nothing else is needed but what Christ has done for us. And I'm so grateful for that, that my salvation doesn't depend on what I do. Because if there was something I could do to fix it or earn it, I'm pretty sure I would figure out how to lose it. Right? Because we're good at that as people. I mean, if there's a way, I don't know if you know who the guy Vodi Bakum is. He's a pastor. He's got a ton of YouTube. I do recommend his videos, by the way. He's a really good guy. I met Vodi years ago. Tremendous preacher of the gospel. And one of the things he says, if there was a way to lose my salvation, he says, I guarantee you I could do it. Because I'm just that way. And I get that. Because I'm that way too. But I am grateful that my salvation is based upon the finished work of Jesus Christ. That Christ did what was necessary. It's not based on what Mike does. It's based on what Jesus has done. And that's why we can gather today in confidence, in boldness, in grace to understand the power of God at work in us through Jesus Christ. And that's what Paul wanted them to understand here. Now, we'll kind of get into this a little bit. That, like I said, this is one of those introductory starts to his letter. So there's, you know, he's not going to give you a lot of theology today. That'll come later. All right. But he does say, as he's getting into this, and I love the greeting. I just want to go back to that here just for a few seconds. Verse 3 and 4 and 5 is just a beautiful greeting for these believers. It kind of shares the heart of the apostle. And I know sometimes there are people out there who believe that Paul was this hard-hearted person that said, either you follow my way or I don't have anything to do with you. But I don't think they understand his love and his passion for people, and he wanted them to come to Christ. And notice what he says to these believers again as he says it in verses 3 through 5. I want to read that again. He says, "Grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is the gospel, who gave himself up for our sins so that he might rescue us from the present evil age according to the will of our God and Father, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen." Who rescues who when it comes to salvation? We don't rescue ourselves. It's not an Indiana Jones movie, and I haven't seen the latest one, and I haven't seen the last two, I don't think, but anyway, that's okay, where he somehow miraculously rescues himself. Now, I'm going to date myself. How many of you remember watching when you were younger? You don't have to raise your hand to admit it. The old Batman series with Adam West. Yeah. I will confess, I was an addict. I loved Batman, and when it was, it was weird. It was after it had been on years, and it was on, and they would put it up in my, you know, where I lived. They'd have it on TV, you know, like I think at like 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and it'd be a half hour segments. And didn't you always? They were always had those like three or four part ones, and it always seemed somehow that Batman and Robin found a way to get themselves in a mess, didn't they? One of the bad guys had some really bizarre way to get rid of our crime hero fighting, whatever you want to call it, you know, the superheroes. He had a way, and it was always something bizarre and crazy. And then, of course, that was the cliffhanger, right? And then what? They would stop it, and then you'd have to wait. Now, I was glad then because it was only one day I had to wait because, you know, it was in syndication. It wasn't, you know, like I wouldn't watch. Like when that came out back in the 60s, I believe it was, when it came out, you had to wait the next week, right? Of course, we don't even know what that's like anymore because who watches TV and waits? We binge watch everything on, you know, Netflix or YouTube or whatever. We don't watch it like that anymore. So for those of you who are older, you know what I'm talking about. This young, like, what in the world is he talking about? If I want to see it, I can see it all. I can watch 8 hours in a day. Yeah, no, there was a time you couldn't do that. But anyway, but as I thought of that, I thought there's things that we get ourselves messed up in, things that we can't get out of that we need help. And of course, you know how this show went. They always figured out a way, you know, something on the bat belt, you know, whatever it was. There was always some way they got out. That's the way it works. On the TV show, it works fine that way. But in real life, do you ever find yourself in a situation that you don't think you can get out of? Sure you do. And there are situations that we face, and the older we get, at least I'm learning this, there are things that you face that you just can't avoid. Anybody with me on that one? There are things that are happening, things you have to deal with, things you have to change and alter. And understanding that reality is a hard thing for us to do sometimes. And I think one of the struggles that we see in this text, as we're walking through it, is that people had forgotten in Galatia, some of the believers had forgotten who it was that had delivered them. And they were listening to these people talk, and they thought, well, that sounds like a pretty good idea. I need to follow their lead because this will really help me with some issues that I have in my life. And really what they were doing was leading them down a path that was away from Christ. Because Paul wanted them to understand, as I believe the scriptures are clear, that want us to understand that our salvation, our hope, everything is based in Jesus Christ. He is the one and only that delivers us from our sin, that gives us a relationship with the Father, and he is the one and only one that can walk with us through our day as we seek to become the men and women he's recreated us to be. He's the one who helps us, right? The Holy Spirit empowers us. The Holy Spirit speaks to us. The Holy Spirit guides us so that we can live in a way that exalts and honors God. We do not do that in our own strength. We don't do that in our own power. We don't try harder. We learn to trust more and surrender more and let the Spirit lead. And the more we allow the Spirit to lead our life, the more we can experience the full blessing of what Paul's talked about in these first few verses here in this text, this idea of being overwhelmed. And I think one of the things that we sometimes forget is we kind of get to the point in church where we think we've got it all figured out, don't we? Yeah, nobody said amen to that one. But we do. Because we've been here for a while. We've been coming. We've heard enough sermons. We've read enough of the Bible. We've been in enough Sunday school classes. We've got the basics, and that's fine. And there's really nothing more for us to get. We've got it. We're just here to kind of, yeah. But I believe that if you were to try and plumb the depths of what the gospel really is and what it's done in your life, if you lived 1,000 years, you still wouldn't get it accomplished. The depth of what God has done and continues to do in your life and my life is beyond what we can grasp with these little things between our ears. We just can't fully get it. It's beyond that. And I think the longer I live, the more I understand every day how grateful I am for what God is doing in me and has done, and how God has delivered me from my own stupidity. I'm sure no one else can relate to that. But He does. He moves in ways, He changes in ways, He alters me, He helps me understand and see things from different perspectives. That's the work of the Holy Spirit that is in each and every one of us as followers of Christ, not just pastors. Everybody's a follower of Christ, okay? You have that opportunity, you have that access. I do not have a special access to God any different from any other follower of Christ. Is that clear? That makes sense? All of us as a follower of Christ have that access to God through the Holy Spirit to be encouraged, to be strengthened, to have our faith grown, to understand. You know, when you read the Bible and suddenly it jumps off the page, it comes alive because you say, I get it. That text that you've been struggling, you're like, why is that there? What is he trying to say? And suddenly that's the Holy Spirit. I love when the Holy Spirit does that. I love when I'm awakened to those truths, when I finally understand something that I know I should get this, but I didn't see it that way. And that's the Holy Spirit saying, this is what I want you to see, and how it applies to our lives, and how it changes us, and how it helps us have a better picture of where God wants us to be and what God wants to do in our lives. But there are also teachings out there, if we're not careful, that can sound pretty good. But if you listen to them and just really listen to them, you'll see that they're moving in the wrong direction. Now, I know I pick on politicians a lot up here. Sorry. But have you ever heard a speech from a politician and it sounded really good, and after the more you listen to it, you're like, wait a minute, what did he or she just say? And if you listen to and understand where they're going with it sometimes, then you can see. And it concerns you. And brothers and sisters, I want you, when I preach, I want you to listen to when I preach, not just so I can say, oh, I heard it, but that I am staying true to what the Word of God says. That's my goal. My goal isn't to be creative. My goal isn't to be, you know, extravagant. My goal isn't to be tweeted or whatever. I don't care. My goal is to be faithful to the Word of God. If I'm faithful to the Word of God, then I've done my job. And I will be able to stand before Him, and He will, at least in this area of life, and this area, I can say, Lord, I did what You told me to do. This is what I want to do. And so today, we're wanting to be true to what He says here. And He just kind of said, it's kind of walking through. I'm not going to be that much longer. I say that, and that always scares people when I say that, because that means when a pastor says, I'm almost done, what does that mean? 25 more minutes, right? No, it won't be that long. You can mark it at your watch. And I know I'm sure I've got somebody in here who's got a watch that's timing me anyway, and that's okay. But I did want us just to kind of walk through these last few verses. I love what, I'm encouraged by what Paul says, because it shows his care for these individuals. He says, I am amazed that you are so quickly deserting him who called you by the grace of Christ for a different gospel. I'm hearing some things are going on that you've kind of fallen away from where you need to be, and I'm amazed that you've done this. He's you know, kind of tongue-in-cheek there, but he's also understanding that's because of compassion for them. He loves them. He doesn't want them to be to fall away from where they're supposed to be. But this isn't really another gospel. These people are just disturbing you, and they're distorting the gospel. They're just making stuff up, basically, is what he's saying here. And basically, that's what they do. These false teachers have come in, and they've added to the gospel. And I love what he says here, and he reiterates this in verse 8. He says, even if an angel from heaven, I could just see an angel come down to preach. Angel comes down and preaches to you a gospel contrary to what we have preached, he is to be accursed. And in case you didn't get the point of what he just said, does he not say the same exact thing in verse 9? Basically, if it's not in line with what you've heard, what we know to be true, what is the gospel, which is that we are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, right? That Jesus Christ is our salvation, that what he accomplished on Calvary is what we need, our trust and our giving our lives to him and allowing him to understand what he has done to us, to understand that's what we need. We don't need to go to church more. We don't need to do this or do that. We need to trust Christ. Christ alone. Sola Christos, as the Reformers used to say. I probably butchered the pronunciation of that, but that's okay. I'm Midwestern. I'm allowed to do that, right? He says quite clearly that is not a part of what we are to be a part of. We are to be faithful to it. And he reminds his listeners here of this important truth that we are, his goal isn't to be win a popularity contest. He's not trying to get, of course, he didn't have all the internet then. He couldn't get a bunch of YouTube views and all that kind of stuff. He wasn't trying to do that. His focus was to be faithful to the Word of God. He says, this is what I'm telling you. Who do you think I'm trying to live to please? Am I living to please myself or others? Or am I living to please Jesus? He says, no, he calls himself. And Paul uses this term a lot in his writings. You know, he calls himself a bondservant of Christ. Now, you understand the, just for a second or two here, I want to walk through that. What does it mean to be a bondservant in this culture? It's someone who has surrendered all their rights, surrendered their livelihood, everything, to become a voluntary servant of the person to whom they are bonded to. It's like saying, okay, it's like indentured servitude in a sense, as we would understand it in our context. We'd understand that terminology. You probably remember that from your history studies. He has fully surrendered all his rights, everything about his life, and says, God, says Jesus, whatever you want to do with this life, you have full permission to do with me whatever you want if it achieves the purposes that you have for my life. It's all about what you want, Jesus. It's not about what I want. And Paul understood that, and that's the heart, and you understand the heart that he has for the gospel. That's really the heart of what he desired to be. He wants to be someone who is, the term we would use in the vernacular when I was a youth pastor, being sold out for Christ. But even that doesn't fully quantify what Paul's talking about here. That just kind of gives you a snapshot. And he understands and wants them to understand that that's who he is, that my life is all about Jesus. My life is all about pointing others to the finished work of Christ, of pointing others to the cross, helping them understand who Christ is, what he's done. That's what I'm here for. Everything else doesn't matter. What matters to me is that people come to know Christ and the mercy and the salvation that is offered by God through the sacrifice of his Son. And I know to a lot of us that's pretty elemental because we've heard this before, right? We know what he's talking about. But sometimes we forget. And sometimes we think, well, we got to do something here or something there and just add a little bit more. And brothers and sisters, there's nothing more to add. Jesus has done it all. He paid it all. I think we got a hymn that's called that talks about that, don't we, right? Jesus paid it all to him I owe. You know the hymn. Everything has been accomplished through what Jesus has done. But we're always trying to fix things. How many of you remember Adam and Eve in Genesis? Remember Adam and Eve, right? What was one of the first things they do after they have sinned? Well, that was the next one. Yeah, they lied about it afterwards. That's good. That's right. But what do they do? God's walking through the garden, and what have they done? You remember? They've clothed themselves with fig leaves and stuff, tried to cover themselves. Why did they do that? And where did the shame come from? Because they had disobeyed God. They knew they had disobeyed God, right? And they tried to hide it. And once again, what do we, when we make a mistake, what do we guys try to do? We try to fix it, don't we? Now, I'm going to also date myself. How many of you remember a PBS show called Red Green? Anybody remember that? Red Green. It was a guy who was on, it was a Canadian show. It was hilarious. It was a guy, he was a fix-it guy. It was kind of about the same time as Tim Toolman Taylor was on. It was a Canadian, and he was this guy. He would do really crazy stuff to fix stuff. You can find the clips on YouTube. They're out there. It's just goofy. I mean, it's crazy. But the whole idea was he would try to fix things, and it was usually problems he had created by his own mistakes, and then he would try to fix them because that's what we guys do. We fix stuff, right? That's our job, right? But sometimes you make some problems so bad that you can't even fix it. And I have, and my wife will testify, I have tried to fix things sometimes and made it worse by trying to fix them. Anybody else done that? You know, and that's what, I get that. And we do that a lot in our own, I use that example, because we do that a lot in our own walk with Christ. We try to, well, God, I know I should do this, but I need to fix it. Much like Adam and Eve were trying to do. They tried to fix it. They thought, well, we'll put some leaves on and that'll fix everything. God won't know. God won't realize we did something. And yet, it's funny how we do the same thing today, don't we? We don't put fig leaves on, but we do other things, think, well, God will never know. God doesn't know what I'm thinking. He didn't know what I said yesterday. He didn't know what I did, right? Now, we'd never say that out loud, but in our the way we try to justify ourselves, we try to make things right, we try to fix things sometimes when we make a mistake, it shows that we really do think that. We may not say it audibly, but we're thinking that kind of stuff. And that's part of being human. That's part of that fallen nature that we have that we need deliverance from, that deliverance that comes through Jesus Christ. It doesn't come by trying harder. It doesn't come, you know, by reading a book and doing 14 things. What it comes by is a relationship with Christ as we learn to trust Him and be led by the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit will direct us in a path different than the path we would have taken as we surrender to Him. And that's the ultimate goal as a follower of Christ, is to be led by and be like Christ, isn't it? Isn't that what we want to be? We want to be like Jesus. That's what we say, and I believe we do want that. But how? What was it about Jesus? Was Jesus led by the Spirit of God? Was He not led by the will of God? What was His... I mean, He was faithful to God. You say, well, yeah, but He was God's Son. It's different. How much did Jesus pray? A bunch. I can't even really quantify it, a lot. There were times that Jesus prayed all night. Now, I can't remember the last time I did that. Why would Jesus want to pray all night? I want you to think about that. Don't answer. I want you to think about it. Why would Jesus be so focused on His relationship with the Father, whom He had had intimate relationship? I mean, they're in heaven together. I mean, come on, right? And the whole Trinity thing, I mean, that kind of messes with your head anyway. But that whole idea, but that intimacy that He desired, that relationship, and in the midst of what He was living in this world and the things that He was facing, He was consistently, daily in prayer with the Father. Because He knew how important that was, I believe. And I think that's an example for us. That's how desperately you and I need prayer. If Jesus needs prayer, how much do I need prayer? Right? If He needed to pray, I think I need to pray a whole lot more even than Jesus. I mean, I don't know if it's possible, probably not, but I need prayer. And why? That prayer is that connection to God, that spiritual connection, that daily connection, that daily time with Him, so that it helps us to become in tune with His will and the direction that He has for us to live the life that He's called us to live. But sometimes we get caught up in just doing stuff and don't really think about why we do it or really focus on the motivation or the spiritual. We just kind of think, well, I'll just do what I need to do and get it done. Rather than what it seems as I look at Scripture, God is more focused on who you are than what you do. And that's a message I ain't got time for this morning. We'll just leave that alone. I want you to think about that. God is more focused on who you are more than what you do. And as a follower of Christ, your identity is found in who you are, in that relationship with Him, okay? Not what you do. And what we do on Sunday morning is fine. We sing songs, we praise God, we pray. You sit there and suffer through me preaching, whatever. We do all that, right? And we're trying to do that in hopes to grow in our walk with God, to understand more about who God is. That's what our hope is. That's the purpose. And the reason we do that, why, is because we want to be in a deeper, more abiding relationship with Jesus, right? That's why you're here today. I mean, you could have found better things to do this morning than come to church, right? Well, we could have found other things to do, couldn't we? There's a joke. You know what the most well-attended church in America is? Bedside Baptist. Yeah. It's the number one Baptist church in America by far. Largest attendance every week. It's easy, it's tempting to just kind of say, well, you know, but it's not so much about the things we do, it's more about who we are. And what I mean by that, as I've tried to say, and I probably don't do a good job of saying it, it's as a follower of Christ, when Jesus saves you, He doesn't just change the want to. He changes your identity. What's Paul say? You become a new creation, he says in 2 Corinthians 5:17. A brand new creation. You are radically transformed as a work of God, as the Holy Spirit enters you and changes you in that moment. You are a new creation, a brand new person because of what God has done. Your identity, everything about you has changed because God knows that the way to change your actions is to change who you are. I'd love to say that in that one moment, then it's fixed and it never changes, but anybody have old habits they have trouble getting rid of? Oh, really? Like when you see a piece of chocolate cake, it's just no problem for me. Well, maybe not for you. I mean, there's a reason why there's a piece of chocolate cake there. What? If it's in my presence, I know why it's there. Okay, maybe you hate chocolate, but whatever. You know, there's things that we have in life. We know there's certain various things that we know that can trip us up and lead us on a path we don't need to be on in our walk with God. And what we have to do is surrender to God, allowing God to lead us on the path that He has for us, not the path we have for ourselves. And the other part of that is learning to take responsibility when we fail. How many of you have ever seen a child do something wrong, and when they are asked, did you do that, they say no? And maybe when we were children, not maybe, when we were children, we did that, didn't we? It's like that old Family Circus cartoon. You've heard me quote it. You've seen it 1,000 times, right? The Not Me Phantom. Anybody remember that Family Circus cartoon? You can find it. There's a million images of it. Where there's this, the parents come into the house and it's a mess. I mean, it's crazy mess. And they ask the kids, you know, Family Circus, everybody know, everybody, if you look up Family Circus, it's kind of cute. It's an old, I don't even think it's in print anymore. I think it went out of print years ago. But anyway, Family Circus was this kind of cartoon, you know, a daily cartoon. And there's this mess in the house and they ask, who did this? And there's stuff, you know, knocked over, broken and whatever. And they all said, not me. Not me. Which is what we do, right, when we're caught. Did I do that? No, that wasn't me. You're the only one in the room who did it. Well, it was the Not Me Phantom. That was the idea behind the cartoon strip. You know, that it's somebody, there's something else. There's this mystical force out there that does it. And you kind of hear that in the, if you go back to Genesis 3, you kind of see that alluded to with that conversation, because when God starts going through, well, why did you do this? When it finally comes to a point, we'll say, well, we ate of that tree we weren't supposed to eat. You know that one you told us not to? The only one you told us not to eat of, we ate of that one. Okay, how did that happen? And they start passing the blame, don't they? Right? Adam blames Eve, right? That's what we do. Then Eve blames the serpent. Because it wasn't a dog. I guess that's a joke, okay? You know, what it would generally have been. You know, the dog gets blamed for everything, right? But she blames the serpent. And we do that. We pass, well, it was this person's fault. It was my upbringing. It was this. We blame things for the way that we are rather than taking responsibility. And part of being a follower of Christ is learning to take responsibility for my own failures. And knowing that God can change me, but I have to take ownership. A key part of becoming a Christian is understanding and coming to that realization that you are a sinner. Right? Admitting that you are a sinner, that you are broken, that you need a Savior. That's, without that, it's really hard to move beyond in a relationship. You can't have a relationship with God. That's the first step, is admitting that. As it teaches in the Scriptures, that you have failed and you have fallen. But the beautiful thing in all that is, even though you and I have failed, there is a God who loves us and is willing to restore us and save us, which is what Paul has talked about here. Now, I really am winding down. I said I was going to wind down, and before I get to my 20 minutes, I wasn't going to go that far. I'm just about done. I want us to just simply take a moment to think about this, as we're going to be walking through a lot of things. Is our salvation is based in who? Anybody awake out there? What's our salvation? How do we know we're a follower of God? What is it that makes us a child of God? Well, I'm hearing a lot. Jesus. That's it. Does being a Baptist make you a child of God? Sorry. You can be Presbyterian and still be a child of God, but it doesn't make you a child of God because you're Presbyterian. Nothing wrong being a Presbyterian. You can pick any denomination. It's not about the denominational label. It's about the relationship with Jesus. And it's not Jesus plus this. It's not Jesus plus baptism. Sorry to my brothers and sisters who believe that. I hope one day they'll get it right. But that's not in the Scriptures. And I know the Scriptures, they quote for that, and I can help them understand that if they want to walk through it a little bit. That's not what it says. Salvation comes by Christ and Christ alone. So all you need is Jesus. And I don't know how that makes you feel, but for me, to know that it's not dependent upon what I can do, that's a great relief. And also a great hope. Know you are loved more than you could ever imagine. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for this time. I thank you for this opportunity that we have to follow you, to trust you, and to hear your word. And I pray, Father, I've been faithful to proclaim your word today to your people in a way that was clear, hopefully as concise as it needed to be, but most importantly, that's faithful to the scriptures. And Lord, we just pray, Lord, that if there's one here today that has not come to know you as a follower of Christ and maybe trusted in something else, and even church membership, though it's a wonderful thing, does not save us. It is a relationship with Christ that saves us. And if there's one here today listening to me, either personally and present or via the internet, and needs that insurance and would like to nail that down, then Father, today's a great day for that. There's no better day of salvation than today. Use this time in whatever way you desire. Thank you for it. If it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.